Thank you very much, Luke. It transpired in our correspondence, Luke and myself, that it turns out we also went to the same primary school way back then, Ferndale Primary. So our roots go back a long way. It turns out that Ferndale has done okay in the ensuing years. So we will talk about that more. Thank you for that introduction, which I wrote. Made sure it sounded important and makes me look good. If I'd asked my wife to do that, I doubt she would have been so kind. Before I begin tonight, what I would like to do, first of all, is pray, and then just give you a little bit of my backstory. You might have noticed that I somehow transitioned from phys ed to theology, which is another way of saying, how did the guy who couldn't even handle English end up dealing with ancient Greek and Hebrew? I'm still trying to figure that out myself, but I'll share a bit of that story, and then we'll get into our theme for tonight. Father in heaven, I'm grateful for the opportunity to share about your resurrection. Would you give us eyes to see and ears to hear your truth, and would you give us hearts to receive it in a spirit of grace? Father, we look forward to all that you would do among us, and we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I guess a bit of my background story. I actually didn't grow up in a church family, quite irreligious, in fact, although my stepmother had a sort of quasi-Catholic background. We never really went to church. We didn't really pray before meals or anything like that. And when I began going to a local youth group in Ferndale, the gospel actually didn't make a lot of sense to me. And I sort of I raised hell for about a year and a half, and slowly but surely the gospel began to kind of sink in a little bit. And one of the turning points at that time as a 14 or 15 year old was having a conversation with one of the leaders who I want to honor tonight. Her name's Sally Agostino, and she was saying to me, Dave, do you really think you could believe this stuff about the gospel and the resurrection? And because I was 14 and I knew everything, my answer was, no, I'm too scientifically minded. I could never believe that sort of thing. And I think at that moment she began to pray for me for the ensuing 6 months, because by the end of the year I had in fact become a Christian. God had saved me, and I was as surprised as anyone. And when I went home, I shared my faith with my parents, and they looked at me kind of funny and were like, what are you talking? You're already a Christian. What are you talking about? This was in a time and a place when Christianity still very much had cultural influence, and to be born in Australia or to be born in the UK or to be born in the US was automatically to make one a Christian, in the same way that someone might be born in Cambodia and be automatically considered Buddhist, or someone might be born in the Middle East and be considered Muslim. So I didn't have that church background, but I began to grow in the faith, but not without doubts. I'm talking about resurrection tonight, and if you try sharing this with your friends, they will look at you a little bit weird. It's a strange thing. I hate to break this to you, but resurrection is weird. I hate to break that to you. Like, sometimes, how many of you, be honest, you've made fun of another religion or cult under your breath? I can't believe those Mormons really believe that, or whatever it might be. People think that about us. Resurrection? Are you mad? If I went to you tonight and said, just, you know, hypothetically, this didn't really happen, but let's say last Friday my grandfather died, and then I say, and we were grieved and we were mourning, but good news, on Sunday he was alive again, you'd say one of two things. You'd say, Dave, either he wasn't dead, or you're crazy, you're having hallucinations, he's not really alive. I'll take you to the grave and we'll deal with this together. You need help. So resurrection is weird, but resurrection is also fundamental to the Christian faith. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 15 says it's of first importance. He goes so far as to say, in fact, that without the resurrection, our faith is futile and that we are to be pitied more than any other people. So if you are not a believer here tonight, and I say this with all seriousness, if you are not a believer here tonight and you have an answer for this question, that you think is convincing, please share it with some of us. Because if we are following a lie, we want to follow the truth. And we are deceived, and we need to be set straight. I mean that sincerely. As of yet, I'm standing here today because as of yet, I have not come across that answer. Because I actually believe, looking into the historical evidence, that the resurrection really does make sense of what we find, not only in the scriptures, but in extra-biblical material as well. And so that's what we're going to dig into today. Paul, interestingly enough, Paul actually assumes resurrection. He doesn't argue for it. When he's talking to the Corinthians, he's not so much concerned about the fact that they believe in a resurrection, but that they have a wrong belief about the resurrection, and he aims to set that straight. So 2,000 years removed, where are we at today? Is it little more than a myth or a lie? Or is it something more substantial? Can we really believe what we find in the scriptures? And what should we be looking for in there? That's what I hope to show you tonight. And what I hope to show you is, if you are a believer, that if you've maybe wrestled with this before, that you actually do have good historical grounds for believing this, that contrary to popular belief, you don't have to leave your brain at the front door when you enter this building. And for the non-believer, if you are here tonight, I want you to at least acknowledge that Christians aren't crazy in this, that we've had 2,000 years to think about this. We're not following this because we think it's nice. We're not following this because we think it makes our life better. At the most essential level, we're actually following this because we believe that it's true. And that it actually impacts everything else that we believe and how we live. And so I would hope that you would be open to some of that today. Now, a brief word about Greco-Roman background, and the Jewish background, in fact. One of the curious facts about the resurrection is that nothing in the Greco-Roman or Jewish world really prepared people for an event like this. So if you were to ask a normal Greco-Roman in the Mediterranean 2,000 years ago what their thoughts were about death and the afterlife and things of that nature, one of the things that would become very quickly apparent is that they saw the body in the material world as something evil, or something at least bad, and something to be liberated from. That freedom came at death because the body was separated from the soul and the soul was free. And so there was no idea of resurrection in that worldview. In the Jewish worldview, there was something of a resurrection belief. We know that the Pharisees believed in the resurrection. We know that some Jewish people, including the Sadducees, who were the religious elite of Jesus' day, they did not believe in the resurrection. But for those who did, it wasn't so much about a single man being raised in the middle of history, but about all of humankind being raised at the end of history to face judgment. And so even within that Jewish way of thinking, there wasn't really any paradigm for thinking, oh, the Messiah will die and be resurrected. That actually was not there. And so this was something completely unprecedented. So I just wanted to get that out of the way as we dig into this. Now, before getting into some of the positive arguments for resurrection, I want to develop the case for the negative and a few people who are talking about it. And the first person I'm going to mention is a lady by the name of Francesca Stavrakopoulou. Don't ask me to say that surname again. She is actually my head of department at the University of Exeter. She's a Hebrew Bible scholar. She's also an atheist. She's also a lovely lady, and she is wonderful company at dinner parties. And I say that with all sincerity, not just because she holds the gavel over my head when it comes to giving me a PhD. She really is lovely. But on this, we are at loggerheads. In her mind, Jesus, if he even existed, she isn't even sure that Jesus existed, but if he did, she believes that he was buried in a mass grave. And in taking that opinion, she's drawing on the work of a gentleman named John Dominic Crossan. Now, what I'm going to do now is quote a series of tweets that Francesca actually gave in response to a Guardian article, which was about the alleged discovery of what might have been Jesus' tomb. So this is what she says on Twitter. And Twitter is not an authoritative source. She's sort of flying off the cuff a little bit, calling it as she sees it. But this is what she had to say. Jesus of Nazareth was probably buried in a mass grave after execution. But this is still an interesting excavation. Next tweet, she continues, to clarify, no direct contemporaneous evidence for Jesus exists, just a few early Christian writings and a disputed reference in Josephus. She continues, some New Testament scholars think the Gospels and Acts, etc., attest to eyewitness accounts, but this is just critically flimsy and unpersuasive. She continues, particularly when they argue supernatural or divine acts are to be taken as a category of historical possibility. That's Francesca Stavrakopoulou. Now, an acquaintance of mine, Andrew Wilson, I don't know if any of you are familiar with a theology blog called Think Theology. Andrew Wilson is a regular contributor there. The guy's a genius. And he took issue with some of this, and he did a blog post, quoted some of those tweets, and then this is a portion of Andrew's response here. And it follows on this assumption that because something is potentially divine or supernatural, that it can't be a legitimate category for historical thinking. Andrew says this. He says, now we're zeroing in on it. We cannot take seriously historical sources or contemporary scholars who believe that God acts in history, because otherwise we might end up having to consider all manner of ancient nonsense, including bodily resurrection, presumably. So let's double up on the scare quotes and attempt to shame people who allow for the possibility that materialism might be untrue. After all, if it wasn't, then secular Westerners might be wrong about something, and we can't have that, can we? That was Andrew's response. One more tweet from Francesca. She says, so why should historians of the Bible entertain supernatural or divine explanations? And she says, it's just silly. Silly. And then Andrew Wilson. So just to be clear, there's no contemporary evidence that Jesus existed at all, but if he did, he was buried in a mass grave. But if he wasn't, he didn't leave an empty tomb behind. But if he did, it had nothing to do with anything divine or supernatural. Got it? That's Andrew Wilson's response to Francesca. What's interesting about Francesca's assertions, except for her denial of Jesus existing, I don't think many historians actually believe that. A minority do, but not the majority. But she draws predominantly from the work of a couple of well-known gospel skeptics, John Dominic Crossan and Bart Ehrman, both of whom doubt the veracity of the gospels, including the accounts of Jesus' passion and resurrection. Now, these doubts or denials, when you hear them for the first time, they sound really new and elaborate and contemporary, but they're not. From the very beginning, people have been denying or throwing into doubt questions about the resurrection, and you actually see them in Scripture. In Matthew 28, in fact, Matthew reports that some of the religious establishment, the Jewish religious establishment, bribed Roman soldiers to circulate a rumor that the disciples stole Jesus' body. You've read that, right? Have you read that bit? Yeah. I want you to slow down and think about that for just a minute. Matthew is writing, 30 to 40 years after the events, and he's saying in a public document that's open to verification, he's talking about a rumor. And the only way Matthew can actually say anything like that in a public document is what? Is if it's true, that people can actually say, yeah, I've heard that rumor. I remember that. And what does that rumor presuppose? The fact that there is an empty tomb somewhere to be had. And so these denials are nothing new. Interestingly enough, even in Matthew's gospel, we see that some of the disciples doubt the resurrection. They're gathered there, they're listening to Jesus, and it says, but some of them still doubted. Like, I had a really bad breakfast, like whatever those mushrooms and eggs were, they weren't the mushrooms I was hoping for, and I'm seeing Jesus, and we saw him crucified. I'm not sure we can, really, Jesus, that's you? So even the disciples had doubts, and why would you put that in a public document, open it up to scrutiny, when you're trying to convert people to your cause, if it's not in fact grounded in some kind of truth? It just doesn't make much sense. So those sort of critiques and those challenges actually appear within the scriptures themselves. And they were in public documents that anyone at the time of Matthew or Mark or Luke or John or Paul, they could actually go and check it out. They could go and verify it to be certain of the truth which they had heard, which is exactly the purpose that Luke says he writes for. I've written this for you, Theophilus, so that you might know the truth of what you have heard. Early into the 3rd century, there's a famous skeptic called Celsus, and we know about him because he is quoted at length by one of the early church fathers, Origen. And I'm going to read this extended quote of Celsus for you, and what you'll see is that a lot of the critiques that Christians still face today over this were actually around, 1800, 1900 years ago. This is Celsus. But the question is whether anyone who was really dead ever rose with a veritable body. Or do you imagine the statements of others not only to be myths, but to have the appearance of such, while you have discovered a becoming and credible termination to your drama in the voice from the cross when Jesus breathed his last, and in earthquake and the darkness? That while alive, he was of no assistance to himself, but that when dead, he rose again and showed the marks of his punishment and how his hands were pierced with nails? Who beheld this? A frantic woman, as you state, and some others, perhaps of those who were engaged in the same system of delusion, who had either dreamed so, owing to a peculiar state of mind, or under the influence of a wandering imagination, had formed to himself an appearance according to his own wishes. Which has been the case with numberless individuals. Or, which is most probable, one who desired to impress others with this portent, and by such a falsehood to furnish an occasion to impostors like himself. Now, the language is slightly archaic, but I think you can at least get the gist of Celsus' argument here. He goes after the first witnesses, a frantic woman. He goes after their state of mind, delusional, wandering imagination. And he talks about the possibility that the whole narrative could be a complete fabrication. So, although there are many skeptics today, none of their skepticisms are new. All of this was being had 1800, 1900 years ago. And that was sort of the state of play in the early church. Fast forward to 21st century, what are some others saying? I'm going to start with a Perth boy, Archbishop Peter Carnley. No longer in Perth, I think he's moved to the eastern states, but Archbishop Carnley was very skeptical of the resurrection, and he saw it more likely as a metaphor, and I'm going to quote him here. He says, "For his birth to his death on the cross thus points us to the quality of the self-giving remembered to have been in his life. And the Easter stories of the empty tomb and the first appearances, in turn, raise the possibility of knowing that same self-giving still in the ongoing life and work of the Christian fellowship." So for Carnley, resurrection is all about remembrance. The raised one, whom the first witnesses claimed to recognize from Easter Day onwards, was not a new and anonymous presence, but the very presence of their remembered master and teacher who had been crucified on the cross. What Carnley does there, he spiritualizes the resurrection. And to remember Jesus in our hearts and to live as he lived in terms of his self-giving, for him, that's the message of the resurrection story, but it's a metaphor. That's Peter Carnley. John Dominic Crossan, some of you may have heard of him, he's a little less charitable. To summarize, he basically believes that Jesus was buried in a mass grave and his flesh probably eaten by wild dogs. There's nothing nice to say about that, and there's no sugarcoating it. And then in terms of the Gospels and their narrative, he puts it down to legendary development. So for Crossan, what he does, he raises serious doubts about the Passion narrative overall. He sees, for instance, Joseph of Arimathea as a literary character, a literary device created by Mark, and then the other Gospels consequently followed suit, and adding and varying other details as they saw fit. For Crossan, if he can cast doubt on the Gospel narratives, if there is no Joseph of Arimathea, for example, then there is no tomb to speak of. And if there's no tomb to speak of, we then end up with Jesus in a mass grave left to the dogs. For Crossan, the passion narratives are not so much prophecy historicized as they, for him, the passion narratives are prophecy historicized, which is to say the gospel writers went and looked at the Old Testament and then sort of tried to bring that into their time and place in the life of Jesus after the fact. And he doesn't see it as history remembered. Another way to put it, actually, I think that might be a little more accurate, might be to say that he sees the passion narratives as prophecy mythologized, which is to say it's a blend of fact and fiction. Yes, he agrees Jesus was crucified, but can we and we can trust the Gospels on that point. But as for the burial, or for the person of Joseph of Arimathea, or the resurrection, or any of the other miracles, total fabrication. We can't trust the Gospels at all on those points, if you were to believe Crossan. Bart Ehrman, we're going to go a little bit deeper with Bart Ehrman, because he is one of the most common people that is read today. And his summary is that Jesus was probably left on the cross to be eaten by scavengers, which did actually happen in antiquity. And then the Gospels were subject to legendary development. That's Ehrman's take on it. Now, the first thing we need to note for Ehrman is that for him, any study of history must a priori rule out anything reeking of the miraculous or supernatural. As a historian, he will not allow for anything miraculous or supernatural. Those categories don't fit into the category of history. And since, I quote him here, since historians cannot assume those beliefs, they cannot demonstrate historically that such miracles happened. Ehrman goes so far as to say that for a historian who is open to the supernatural or the miraculous, he says that historian must silence those presuppositions, sit on them, or otherwise squelch them when engaging in their historical investigation. In other words, Ehrman holds to an Enlightenment view of the world. He is a strict materialist. And so anything that does not submit to those Enlightenment material principles is not permitted as evidence. So you cannot sort of claim God did this, even if the evidence suggests, well, actually, maybe God did do something here. For him, that's not a category that's possible. Now, Ehrman also argues about this. He says that the most reliable witnesses, and this is important, are those who are disinterested, neutral observers who are interviewed close to the time of the events, and that they show consistency without telltale signs of collaboration. Now, I agree with the latter point that Ehrman makes there, that when you're looking at testimony, you don't want telltale signs of collaboration. That makes it look like a conspiracy. So if you're a policeman, for example, and you're investigating a car crash at a major intersection, and you're interviewing witnesses, depending on whether someone's on the north, south, east, west side of that intersection, they will all give you roughly the same story, but with varying details according to what they saw. Do you understand? And so what police look for in those kinds of reports is a good deal of overlap, but also a healthy amount of discrepancy. If they have both overlap in information and discrepancy, they think they've actually got a pretty good summary of the events. If you were to ask all of those witnesses what happened and they all gave you exactly the same testimony, alarm bells go off. They've conspired. They've tried to set their record straight before the police arrive, tried to close any loopholes. And so Ehrman is right on that count. But on this question of the disinterested observer, not so much. Why would the disinterested observer be paying any attention whatsoever? That's what I would like to ask. And in fact, one Swedish scholar, his name is Samuel Bioskog, he actually argues that in the Greco-Roman world, the best witnesses were not the dispassionate observers, but rather the ones who were socially involved, or even better, actively participating in the events, kind of like the disciples. He actually, I'll quote him here on this, he says, involvement was rather the essential means to a correct understanding of what had really happened. Does that make sense? See, if just because you're passionate about something, and just because you're involved in something, doesn't make you an unreliable witness. In fact, it may make you a better witness because you're the one paying most attention. You're the one who is most deeply involved. You're the one who has that much to gain by it being true. And that's what ancient historians actually looked for, rather than that enlightenment, disinterested standoff, be objective view, which actually no one really has. So I'll take Ehrman to task on that. So what does Ehrman say about all of this, about the burial and the empty tomb? I'm going to move quickly here, so try and keep up. I don't like using, ordinarily I'd probably use a PowerPoint, but I hate technology. Like, I use an Android, which is awesome, but I have a Moleskine. I jot stuff down in that instead. I just find that works better. So try and keep up, and for what it's worth, I can email you these notes, and they can be distributed to anyone who's interested in them. Is that cool? Is that fair? So Ehrman has about 8 points about the empty tomb and about 8 points about Joseph of Arimathea, 3 or 4 points about the empty tomb. Here we go. He says this: because Joseph of Arimathea is a member of the Sanhedrin, he is unlikely to have asked for Jesus' body. That's his first critique. And he suggests that what this means is that Mark made up the story, or that he took it from another tradition. That's what he says. Secondly, he says that Paul, the Apostle Paul, shows no awareness of Joseph of Arimathea in his letters. And since Joseph of Arimathea is not mentioned in an early creed in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that may betray that Joseph of Arimathea is a fictional device used by Mark to create a new tradition. He goes on, Joseph of Arimathea also does not appear anywhere in Acts or the apostolic speeches. You don't hear anything of Joseph of Arimathea in the apostolic speeches or in any of the teaching in Acts. For what it's worth, Ehrman regards the speeches in the book of Acts to be made up by Luke. What I would argue is more likely is that Luke summarized the accounts of what was preached, and we simply have the cliff notes to what was being spoken of at the time. He then goes on to say, and if you've been paying attention, you'll pick up on something here. He says that Luke's use of different sources cannot guarantee harmony with his earlier sources, and if there's no harmony, then someone is changing something or making it up. Now, remember that conversation we had about witnesses and corroboration, but no collaboration? So what he's saying on the one hand is we want to make sure there's no collaboration, and on the other hand, he's looking for perfect harmony. Like, he wants his cake and is trying to eat it too. He's arguing out of both sides of his mouth at that point. So I don't know how he gets there with that. He demands near perfect harmony on the one hand, but he's already acknowledged that if he had perfect harmony, that would be evidence of collaboration. So, you know, which way does he want it? I don't know. He goes further. He says, Jesus didn't have family in Jerusalem. True. And therefore, he had no tomb in which to be buried. The disciples fled the scene, so they couldn't bury him. So we have to find someone to bury Jesus. Ah, Joseph of Arimathea. That'll work nicely. Thank you very much. So that's the only option for Ehrman in that regard. He also disputes information about the Roman crucifixions. He says that Roman crucifixions usually left people on the cross to be eaten by carrion feeders, like vultures, birds, wild dogs, and such. Now, to be fair, Ehrman provides primary documentation of that. That did actually happen. But what's in dispute is whether that was the norm or whether there was more variation in the process than what Ehrman actually concedes. He also suggests that the Romans didn't really care much for Jewish sensitivities. This is a half-truth. The Romans could certainly enforce peace at the point of a sword, but the Romans were often more diplomatic than that, and it was part of their policy to expand the empire that they allowed local people to maintain their local religious beliefs and customs. So you could be a fully functioning Jew with regard to all the temple ceremony and pomp under Roman leadership as any time in Israel's history. And so there's a bit of a question mark about that. Would the Romans really deny Jewish law here? And that's one of the arguments that we'll proceed with soon. And finally, all of the examples that he gives from the primary documentation, none of those documents that he cites actually occur in Jerusalem or Israel. And that's really significant because obviously Jerusalem, Israel is a very unique culture in that empire. It's totally different to what you would expect to happen elsewhere in the empire. And so although we concede Ehrman's accuracy concerning the documents that he cites, whether or not they are like what would happen in Israel is actually subject to a lot of dispute. Now, to the empty tomb, which he also doubts, here's what he says. He says first, the empty tomb is probably a late tradition, therefore unreliable. He suspects that Mark was written 35 to 40 years after the fact, which is in the ballpark. It's not far from thereabouts to our best guess. But he deems that to be problematic. Of course, if Mark is utilizing other sources, you actually get earlier to the time of Jesus. So even that one is a little bit up in the air. And even if it's 35 years afterwards, that's still within living history of people who would be still alive and who were alive 30, 40 years ago when Jesus was in fact crucified. It would be like asking maybe some of the, say it politely, the elders in this room about what they remember of, say, the Gulf War back in 1991. We're almost 30 years removed from that now, and they would still be able to tell you, like it was yesterday, some of the stuff that happened. That's the kind of testimony we're dealing with in Mark, Matthew, Luke, John, probably a little bit later. So that's another one. Next, he argues that Paul doesn't mention an empty tomb, which is like, really? Now, Paul doesn't explicitly say empty tomb, but he does talk a heck of a lot about being buried, which presumably means a tomb, and he talks about being raised, which presumably helps understanding an empty tomb being implied there. Wouldn't you agree? And so if you were to look in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, Galatians 1, 1 Corinthians 15, Romans 6, there's all this resurrection imagery of being dead and being raised and being buried and being raised, which implies a tomb. One other thing he mentions, and it's a common defense for Christians concerning the testimony of the resurrection, and that is the issue of women being the first witnesses at the tomb. Now, in a legal setting, this is important because, generally speaking, women weren't considered viable witnesses in a court of law in the ancient world. Some of you may have heard this. Your testimony, unfortunately, wasn't valid. And so the argument goes, but if the Gospels put the women there first, why would they do that? That's counterproductive. Surely they'd put the apostles first. Now, Ehrman says, well, yes, but in the ancient world, the embalming process for dead bodies fell to the women. And so it would be, in fact, the women who, if they're going to the tomb to embalm Jesus' body and prepare it for proper burial, they would in fact be naturally the first witnesses. But having said that, and you know, we can accept Ehrman's point regarding the dating, Christians at that point were still coming under legal pressure concerning their faith. And so one would actually expect the disciples to come more to the foreground and in terms of the narrative to legitimize the movement. But they never actually do that. And I think that speaks to the authenticity of the Gospels. So in summary, for Ehrman's position, he casts doubt on whether or not Joseph of Arimathea existed. He questions whether or not there was an empty tomb at all. But he does believe that the disciples had real visions of Jesus. They really had visions after his death, whether they were hallucinations or something else. Now, for Ehrman, what he would say is that it was these visions that catalyzed the need for the disciples to create an empty tomb narrative within the Gospels so that they could convince listeners that Jesus was indeed resurrected. That's Ehrman's position in 5 minutes. So what does the Christian say to those allegations? Some of them are quite substantial. Do we have good answers? I would like to suggest, yes, we do. Despite the critiques, we can say a few things in response to Ehrman, to Crossan, to Carnley, to Stavrakopoulou, I'll raise a few points briefly, then go through them in detail. So first thing we could say in response to Bart Ehrman is, first of all, his description of Roman policy is actually incomplete, and it fails to pay special attention to Roman policy in Israel at the time. Secondly, regarding his arguments of Joseph of Arimathea, he doesn't adequately consider Jewish custom and law. Thirdly, he doesn't account adequately for historical archaeological evidence. You'd be surprised as to what we have found in the caves in the Middle East. Fourth, Ehrman's theories don't sufficiently account for the reaction of Jesus' enemies, who also seem to agree that the tomb is empty. That's a big problem. If the enemies of Jesus actually agree that the tomb is empty, that's positive testimony from a negative or aggressive witness against your case. That actually looks really good. If your enemies say, yeah, that tomb's empty, that counts for something. And so he doesn't account adequately for that. Finally, he doesn't cite any primary references contradicting the gospel accounts of the empty tomb. And there's a simple reason for that. There aren't any. Given that these gospel accounts were public records that were circulating around the whole empire, it is incredible to think that if there was no empty tomb, there is not a single document that says, actually, the gospels are wrong. Are you believing that rubbish? There's not a single document that says that. And so that in large part, argument is actually arguing from silence in many respects. And this is strange, again, because they're public documents. They're open to verification, even if they were written 30, 40 years after the events. So briefly, how am I doing for time, by the way? Am I all right? Okay. I'll go as quickly as I can. Roman policy. Concerning crucifixion is actually quite interesting. Ehrman cites a Jewish person who was living in a city called Alexandria. Alexandria at the time was in northern Egypt on the southern half of the Mediterranean, still part of the Roman Empire. And he cites Alexandria in a case where someone was buried after execution, which would seem to point in favor of the Gospels, that Jesus was buried after execution, just like this person was that Philo talks about. Only that Ehrman actually says, no, that, it's not what it seems. That's the exception that proves the rule. Now, one of the problems when Ehrman cites Philo in this regard is that he neglects the surrounding verses, which actually give vital context for our understanding. But he also neglects the fact that Philo is living in Alexandria. It's not a place where Jewish law and custom reigns like it did in Jerusalem and the temple that was there. So it's a completely different social and religious context with different laws in place for the people. And what I would also add to that is that we actually have evidence in the ancient documents that clemency was sometimes granted to the condemned, even those who may have been crucified. I'm going to quote from something written by a guy called Justinian, something called The Digester, and it's all about legal procedures. It's very interesting for a guy like me who likes to look at ancient documents from 2,000 years ago. But for you, really, Dave, you're going down this road, bear with me, you'll see why. This is Justinian from The Digester. He says this, "The bodies of those who are condemned to death should not be refused their relatives. And the divine Augustus, in the 10th book of his life, said that this rule had been observed. At present, the bodies of those who have been punished are only buried when this has been requested and permission granted, and sometimes it is not permitted, especially where persons have been convicted of high treason." So you're seeing there's a bit of variance in this rule. Sometimes they're buried, sometimes they're not. Sometimes it depends what the charge is. But sometimes, oftentimes, in fact, people are buried. "Even the bodies of those who have been sentenced to be burned can be claimed in order that their bones and ashes, after having been collected, may be buried. The bodies of persons who have been punished should be given to whoever requests them for the purposes of burial." Now, that seems to jive pretty well with what we see in the Gospels when Joseph of Arimathea goes to the Romans and says, "Can we have the body so we can bury it?" Now, here's the next thing. It's very, put yourself in ancient Jerusalem. Think about this. Think about all that you know that the Jews believe at that time. One of the most important things for the Jewish people is ritual purity. And it's not just for the people, it's for the land. It's for the land. Can you imagine if there was a crucifixion right outside Jerusalem at the time of Passover, when the city is heaving with maybe 100, 150,000 people? Can you imagine the Romans actually not burying the body in those circumstances? Knowing what you know of Jewish law and custom, it's actually unfathomable. If the Romans tried to get away with that, there'd be riots. There would be an uprising. Craig Evans, who's a Christian apologist, says that in these circumstances, burial would have not only have been demanded, it would actually have been expected. Especially given the climate, like Passover was crazy. Like, when you go down to the foreshore for Australia Day, and there's 500,000 people there, Jerusalem's like that at Passover. And do you think they're going to let the Romans desecrate their land by leaving dead bodies out everywhere? No way. There's no way they would let that happen. Interestingly enough, the Romans, as we've alluded to already, they did not demand their subjects to violate their national law. And this is a law that extended to burial. So now I'm going to quote Josephus, who was another ancient Jewish historian. He says this, "Whereas he ought rather to have admired the magnanimity and modesty of the Romans, whereby they do not compel those that are subject to them to transgress the laws of their countries." The Romans didn't mind people obeying national laws, even as they took them over. That's how you keep the people at peace. That's how you invite them into your empire. That's how they assimilate. And in fact, this we find out in the same piece of work, actually, of Josephus. It actually applies to burial as well. He says this, "Customs which included making sure the corpses were buried," and then, here's the quote, "However, there are other things which our legislator ordained for us beforehand, which of necessity we ought to do in common to all men, as to afford fire and water and food, and to such as want it, to show them the roads, nor to let anyone lie unburied." There it is. And the Romans were more than willing to accommodate national laws in that respect, so that they didn't actually spark an uprising. And if you know your Jewish history, there were times when things got violent. There was one time Antiochus IV Epiphanes tried to put a statue of himself in the temple, and all hell broke loose. And the Jews actually won a guerrilla warfare campaign against the Romans, and they actually achieved peace for a period of time. It was incredible. So the Jews weren't afraid to fight when they needed to, but the Romans never quite got this bad concerning the burial. They wanted to keep the Jews quiet, let's put it that way, in this regard. Now, all of this leads Craig Evans to say that if Roman governors had failed to have buried the bodies, there is no way they could have kept the peace in Israel. Just wouldn't happen. It's almost certain from what we know of the Jewish people at the time that riots would have ensued, as we've been talking about. And we also, get this, we also know from Jewish documents that if a council like the Sanhedrin condemned a man to death, it was actually their responsibility to bury the body. We have this from the Mishnah. It says this, "Furthermore, anyone who leaves a dead body hanging overnight transgresses a negative command. But if one leaves a body hanging overnight for the sake of its honor, to bring it a coffin or a shroud, he does not transgress a negative command. And such a body would not be buried in the grave of his ancestors, because you committed a crime worthy of death, dishonorable burial. But rather, what they would have is two grave sites set for the courthouse, one of those put to death for decapitation and strangulation, and one for those put to death by stoning and burning." Do you see it there? That if the Sanhedrin condemned someone to death, they actually had to have two tombs set aside for the purposes of burial. It's exactly what we find in the Gospels, and in this case, it was the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. Later on, in fact, after about a year, the body of the deceased person could actually be moved to a family tomb if it was convenient. And in fact, we also have archaeological evidence. Get this. In 1968, people excavating in Israel found the remains of a man called Jehohanan, and he had a nail through his heel from where he'd been crucified. Not only that, his legs had been broken. I want you to think about that, what we know from the Gospels. The Gospels tell us that the legs of Jesus were not broken because he died, but they were going to hasten his death. Why were they going to hasten his death? The Sabbath was coming. Let's suppose that this man, Jehohanan, had his legs broken for that very reason. We don't know if it happened before or after his death. We don't have that evidence. But if it was broken before, then there's every reason to think that his death was hastened so that his death wouldn't pollute the Sabbath, so to speak. And you can go and check that out online and in the books and that sort of thing. It's remarkable evidence, and it looks a lot like what could have happened to Jesus. So all of this tells us that what we see portrayed in the Gospels actually aligns with what we know of Greco-Roman and Jewish history. Ehrman may in fact be wrong in what he claims. In other words, it's very likely that Jesus was buried in the tomb just like the Gospels describe, and that he was probably resurrected. Now, on the empty tomb. Now, if we are right in assuming that Jesus was in fact buried, it's very hard to speak of a resurrection without an empty tomb, right? You can't do that. And this is especially so if you make that claim in a public document that's open to public scrutiny, like the Gospels. This is the kicker. It's really hard to imagine encouraging people to believe your message if there's no empty tomb. Believe in Jesus. And by the way, if you do decide to follow us, you might be killed for joining our group. Sound like a good deal to you? You would want to make sure your tomb was empty before you went out with that message. And as we said earlier, if Matthew's account, or every gospel account, they actually presuppose an empty tomb. And that's a fact that's agreed upon by both the friends and enemies of Jesus. Again, positive evidence from a hostile witness. It does actually stand up to scrutiny. So what about some odds and ends? I focused on the empty tomb because that's where most of the conversation is now. But some of you may have heard a few other possibilities in the past, and I want to deal with those briefly. First thing, witnesses to the resurrection. What do we say about that? Well, in the biblical record, we have women witnessing Jesus resurrected. We have his apostles. We have other disciples, up to 500 of them. We also have his family members, and we have the apostle Paul. Lots of witnesses in a variety of circumstances over a period of 40 days. How do you account for that when all of that's recorded in public documentation for public scrutiny? Unless it is in fact true. One of my favorites in this, and I don't know if you've ever thought about this, have you ever thought about how weird it must have been for Jesus' family to worship him as the resurrected Lord and Messiah of Israel? His mother, brothers, sisters maybe. In Acts chapter 1, we have them recorded with the disciples worshiping. Now, here, let me bring this. If I came to you and said, I'm the Messiah, I'm sinless, I'm back from the dead, who would you go to verify a few of those things? Like, you go to my brothers and sisters, right? It's like, so, did David really sin? And they'd be like, yeah, totally, man. He gave me a wedgie when I was 10 years old, and he told a lie about me, got into trouble with my mom and dad. He totally sinned all the time. You ask the family. My mom and dad can tell you all kinds of horrendous things that I've done. And all of those would prove that I'm not the Messiah. I'm a very naughty boy, for those of you who are familiar with the life of Brian. Now, but Jesus's parents, his mother at least, Mary, we don't know what happened to Joseph, but his mother and brothers are there worshiping him as God after his resurrection. That's astounding, especially when you look into the gospel records and find actually they opposed him. They thought he was nuts. They tried to get him committed to the crazy house. But there they are in Acts, worshiping Lord of heaven and earth, Jesus Christ. Another option. Could Jesus have simply swooned on the cross and revived in the tomb? Have you heard this one? The swoon theory? He wasn't really dead on the cross. You know, yeah, they lashed him to within an inch of his life. Yeah, he carried his own beam almost all the way. Yeah, they drove nails through his wrists and his ankles. And yeah, you know, and yeah, they speared his side. But he totally made it. They took him off that cross. They mummified him in linen. They threw him in that tomb where it was nice and cool, and he totally refreshed. And then he came out of the tomb, which had a stone rolled in front of it, overcame the Roman guard, and he convinced his disciples he was the resurrected Lord of the universe. That's my official response to that line of thinking. The Romans didn't botch crucifixion. They were expert executioners. Secondly, as we've said, Jesus was effectively mummified. Thirdly, he's not going to be able to move a rock in front of his tomb. Fourthly, he's not going to be able to overcome the Roman guard that had been placed there to protect that tomb on pain of death if they fail. And then convince his followers that he's resurrected? Like, no, like if you saw Jesus in that state, you wouldn't be saying, resurrected Lord, yeah. You'd be saying, you survived that? You're breathing? We need to get you to a doctor. I know this great guy. His name's Luke. Let's go. That's what you would say. That's not, and look, to be frank, I think to believe that theory takes more faith than believing in a resurrection, if I may put it bluntly. Well, could the disciples have stolen the body? Unlikely. First of all, they'd have to overpower the Roman soldiers. And I don't exactly see that happening after they've fled the scene of Jesus' death and betrayal. Further, now, do you remember in the gospel accounts, one of the things that was really peculiar about the resurrection and empty tomb account was that the linen that Jesus had been wrapped in had been folded up. You remember that? Are we to suppose that the disciples not only overpowered the Roman guard, moved the stone, but then once inside the tomb, unwrapped Jesus and carried his naked body through the back alleys of Jerusalem in the middle of the night, hoping to get away with the resurrection story? If you encountered the disciples like that, that would be an awkward conversation. John, Peter, I see you have Jesus there and he's naked. Well, this isn't Jesus. Don't know what you're talking about. I'm pretty sure that's Jesus. I think it's unlikely. Let's just put it that way. When you play the script, it just doesn't hold any water. Could the Romans have moved the body? Yeah, they could have. They could have moved the body. But if they did so, they would have saved themselves and us 2,000 years of trouble by producing the body. If you've got a group of Jewish fanatics proclaiming Jesus has risen from the dead and you've moved the body, how are you going to squash that religion forever? By dragging that corpse right down the main street of Jerusalem. And they never did, because the tomb was empty. There was no body to be retrieved, and they didn't move the body. It didn't happen. So where does this leave us? Well, I'm out of options. But I think despite Ehrman's best claims, I don't think it's unreasonable to conclude that Jesus may have indeed rose from the dead. It's an extraordinary claim. It's a supernatural claim. But when the evidence is assessed, it's also a reasonable claim. And I can't compel you to believe. It's a pretty big thing. I can't compel you to believe that someone rose from the dead. But I don't think you can accuse Christians of being gullible for believing it either. We may take it on faith, but it's a reasonable faith. Now, I want to take a few more minutes to talk about some resurrection implications. You see, the Corinthians didn't have a problem with believing in the resurrection, but what they failed to do was to connect it to their own resurrection. Jesus' resurrection is the uncontested fact for Paul, But what's contested is our resurrection. I don't know if you've thought about it, but we're not, our resurrection is not going to be a spiritual thing. It's going to be a bodily resurrection. Jesus came to earth in a physical body, died in a physical body, was raised in a physical body, ascended to heaven in a physical body. And when he comes back, we will be raised in a physical body. We'll have resurrection bodies. It's going to be awesome. I'll be able to drink coffee again without consequence. I've had to give up coffee for the last 2 days because my stomach's troubling me. I've had a splitting headache for 2 days. I can't wait for my resurrection body, thank you. But Paul's point is this, that if Jesus was raised from the dead, but that has nothing to do with our being raised from the dead, our resurrection, that's not something to stake a life on. Life stinks, then you die. So what are the implications if it's true? Well, there's a few. Jesus, you see, is the first fruits of the resurrection. Paul talks about this in 1 Corinthians 15. His resurrection is the guarantee that we will be resurrected. It's like when you pick fruit from a tree. We have an avocado tree in our backyard. Totally blessed. And you know that when the first avocado comes down, you know that more are going to come. You're not looking up there hoping that, well, there's one avocado. I hope the rest are coming. They're coming. Of that you can be assured. It's the same with Jesus in his resurrection in terms of being the first fruits. We'll have a physical reality. Heaven, if you like, the new heavens and the new earth will be a physical reality with physical bodies. We'll have work and ministry to do. Except doctors. There'll be no sick people. Doctors, you're going to have to find new work. Lawyers. Any lawyers in the house? We'll pray for you. No lawyers. But they're going to be out of work because no one's going to be suing each other anymore. It's going to be great. But we will have ministry. And if Jesus is the first fruits, we need to understand this, that one of the ministries of Adam and Eve, if we go back to Genesis, was that they were to rule over creation as vice regents. They were going to be prophets declaring God's truth. They were going to be priests representing God to creation. They were going to be monarchs ruling over God's created order as vice regents. But sin, if you recall the story, ruined that ministry. Sin ruined everything. But God's plan was to actually reestablish that ministry through the Messiah, the son of David. And so we get these foretastes of this being reestablished in the kingdom through Jesus' ministry when he brings order out of chaos, doing what only God can do. Have you ever looked at the story? I hope I'm not going over time now. Just cut me off if you need to. When you look at Jesus calming the storm in Mark chapter 4, that's a really difficult one to apply. I know Adam, you preach here often. When you've preached this, you haven't told everyone here to go to Cottesloe Beach and calm the storm as it comes in, right? That's not the application, right? That's not the application. But what do you see in that story? They're on the water, there's storm, there's chaos, and Jesus, with a spoken word, creates order out of chaos. Doesn't that remind you of Genesis 1? The creating of order out of chaos? Jesus doing that which only God can do, speaking as only God can speak, acting as only God can act. That's what he's doing. He's bringing order out of the chaos. Jesus fulfills the role of Adam and David. He is the last and better Adam or David, slowly bringing creation back into order. And this is where things get amazing, because through the resurrection, what was true of Jesus will become true of us. In fact, creation awaits for that very day when we will be resurrected. Look at Romans 8, 19 through 21. This is what it says. It says, "For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God." That could be also translated, the raising of the sons of God. "For the creation was subject to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself would be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God." I hope that excites you. That the creation is awaiting us to receive our resurrection bodies. And that matters a great deal, because it's not just about us personally. This is about the whole creation being renewed. If you don't think resurrection theology matters, it matters a great deal. Restoration of creation is tied to our restoration and resurrection. Creation was designed to flourish under humanity and will do so again fully when Jesus returns and we are resurrected with him. So what does it mean to live a resurrection life? Well, firstly, resurrection means your body matters and what you do with it matters. The Corinthians, for example, had a skewed view of resurrection, and I suspect it was their skewed view of resurrection that led to their skewed view of their bodies, either using them to sin that grace may abound through licentious living. You know, they said, let us eat and drink and have sex and indulge sexually. And, you know, why? Well, because for tomorrow we die. Bad resurrection theology underlines that way of life. Alternatively, some of the Corinthians saw that and they thought, well, that's bad news. And they began, even if they were married, to completely abstain from sexual relations with their spouse. And Paul had to correct both views because of faulty resurrection theology. What you do with your body matters because it will be resurrected. And the new heavens and the new earth and the new creation are kind of contingent upon that, that our resurrection will lead to the restoration of the whole world. Additionally, if we grant that we live in a world that says life first, then death, which is the natural way things go, right? You know, people are born, life, then death, or, you know, eat, drink for tomorrow, we die. Resurrection, when you think about it, actually inverts that attitude and it says this. It says death, then life. It's completely rebellious against the current order of things. The way my pastor, Roy Scheiner, put it, he says that to invest in sin now, after tasting resurrection life, is kind of like investing in a VCR rental shop today. It's like, why would you do that? Blockbuster, yeah, no. Blockbuster's finished. VCRs are finished. They're obsolete. There's no profit to be had. The resurrection means that if you are a believer, it means that sin actually no longer defines you because you are dead to its power. You know, think about your baptism. Baptism is death, then life. Exactly. It's a complete pushback to the way the world would have us think and live, which means this: you are not so much a sinner saved by grace, although that is true. What it does mean, though, is that your new identity is defined positively as a holy one, as a saint, a child of God who, sadly, on occasion, sins. Now, outside of Christ, the world submits to death, accepting it as the most natural thing in the world. But the resurrection challenges that. The reason we weep and the reason we mourn at funerals is because deep down, we know that death is unnatural. That's why we weep at funerals. Something doesn't fit. It doesn't feel right. They were made for so much more. And when Jesus came into this world healing people and raising people from death, from the world's perspective, that was completely extraordinary. But if you view it from heaven, so to speak, what Jesus was doing wasn't extraordinary at all. What he was actually doing is he was restoring normality. He was restoring the world to the way it should be, the way we want it to be, the way it has to be, the way it will be in the new heavens and the new earth. What the Hebrews call shalom, holistic well-being in every aspect of your life. And that's the promise of the resurrection. That's the hope of every Christian believer. And on a practical level, what this means is that all Christians should be seeking to bring a little bit of shalom in their sphere of life, a little foretaste of the new heavens and the new earth, so that those who do not believe may actually get a taste of that, may actually get a sense of, that's what it means to live under the rule of God in freedom, life to the full. Now, if you're not a believer here tonight, I cannot prove to you that the resurrection really happened. I think the historical evidence stacks up well. But if nothing else, I hope I've at least made you want the resurrection to be true. I hope you at least want it to be true. That a seed might have been planted in your mind and your heart, leading you to further investigation. I really hope that's the case. Now, if you are a believer, I hope that I've been able to show you that your faith is nothing to be ashamed of. That you do stand on strong historical ground. That your faith does actually stand up to scrutiny. And that it can help you live a life worthy of the gospel that you have received. I'm going to end with a quote from G.K. Chesterton. He was an enormous British journalist who lived at the beginning of the early 20th century. And he defined resurrection life really well, I think, when he defined this word, courage. He says this, "Courage is almost a contradiction in terms. It means a strong desire to live, taking the form of a readiness to die. He that will lose his life, the same shall save it, is not a piece of mysticism for saints and heroes. It's a piece of everyday advice for sailors or mountaineers. A man cut off by the sea may save his life if he will risk it on the precipice. He can only get away from death by continually stepping within an inch of it. A soldier surrounded by enemies, if he is to cut his way out, needs to combine a strong desire for living with a strange carelessness about dying. He must not merely cling to life, for then he will be a coward and will not escape. He must not merely wait for death, for that would be a suicide, and he will not escape. He must seek his life in a spirit of furious indifference to it. He must desire life like water and drink death like wine." To me, that's the resurrection life, to desire life like water, but to drink death like wine. Let us pray. Father God, you are good to us in all things. We thank you for the truth of your word. We pray that it's been well received, that my heart for this has been conveyed accurately and solemnly and with the utmost of respect and love. And as we take a break to recalibrate and think about some questions that this may raise, I pray that you would give us guidance and insight that we might live life to the full in light of your resurrection as we await your return. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Awesome. Thank you very much. Just a great overview and introduction to this whole issue of the resurrection and the historical claims of the Christian faith. So you've probably got some questions. I encourage you. We're just going to have a really quick intermission just because we're running a little bit over time. So if you can just go back and grab a pen, piece of paper, write down your questions, throw it in the box down the back there, and we'll collect them up and we'll flick them at David. Awesome. Thank you. Before I begin flicking questions at you, I've always been encouraged that no matter what we look at, no matter what we're assessing, you know, you look at how the court systems work, justice that is executed within, say, the nation of Australia. What do we look for when we're charging someone for a crime? Evidence. But to get the guilty verdict, it has to be beyond reasonable doubt. Are we looking for absolute 100% certainty? No. We're looking at the evidence and we're going, what is beyond reasonable doubt? And does that give us a verdict? And I know a Christian apologist, J. Warner Wallace, who has done this, and he's written a bit about... he's a cold case detective in a previous life, and that's how he's become a Christian, is by weighing up the evidence of the Christian truth claims and going beyond reasonable doubt, I can put my faith in this. And I think you touched on that really nicely, and I just really wanted to sort of think that we don't expect to hold anything up that high, and nor should we do that with what we find within the Gospels. Awesome. Well, let's get into some questions, eh?
If I don't know the answer for tonight, I'm just going to say hashtag alternative facts, and that'll be sort of the end of it if you have a really good question that I don't know the answer to. Just a little heads up.
That's awesome. No, be honest. We'd prefer that. What other historical documents validate the claims made in the gospel? So are there any other extra-biblical documents that help sort of strengthen the case of the New Testament writers about the...
That's a good question, and it's kind of a tricky one because obviously the Gospels are our primary source for what we know about Jesus, and the reason for that is that the early Christians took a great interest in his life and wanted to convey some of that, a lot of that information to us for our benefit. And sort of the Roman historians and some of the other Jewish historians of the time, not so interested, so they don't actually write much about it. But if you read commentaries, if you read, forgive me, man, I'm going to get out of my chair here, but if you read really long academic works, like this is a whole book about the resurrection. It's actually bigger than your Bibles. And what you'll notice when you read those books is they actually go back to a lot of the contemporaneous literature to sort of show where there are certain parallels and how we can know something about the historical context. Josephus does mention Jesus, but there is suspicion over whether or not some Christian got a hold of the document and sort of rammed that bit in there. Repeat the question. I just want to make sure I don't go off on a little rabbit trail and avoid answering your question.
Yeah, so accurately. Other documents that validate the claims made by the Gospels?
In truth, probably not, fundamentally. But when we do look at other ancient documents, say Josephus, Philo, Seneca, Suetonius, I could list a whole bunch of others. But, you know, for example, if you wanted to know about slavery in the ancient world, so when Jesus talks, when slaves are maybe mentioned in one of Jesus's parables, or when Paul talks about slaves in the churches, you can actually look at how slaves were treated by reading some of those ancient sources. So they give us extra insight there. There are so-called Gnostic Gospels. Some of you may have heard about these. The Gospel of Thomas, for example. The Gospel of Peter, that's a crazy one. And some of you may be wondering, well, if we've got these four Gospels, why didn't these other so-called Gospels make it in? What some people would suggest is that, Dan Brown, by the way, has made millions of dollars on this, and it disgusts me. But it's generally regarded that the Gnostic Gospels, as we have them, were probably written after, I think it's about 150 AD, and so they were written after a time when there were any more living witnesses to falsely claim against them, if that makes sense. And so when it came to figuring out what books do we put in the scriptures here, some people would say, well, the books were put in there, and because they were put in there, that makes them authoritative, when in fact what the case is that actually they were put in there because they were already considered authoritative. It wasn't because Constantine decided we need a Bible and we need to make these documents authoritative so Dan Brown can make millions of dollars 2,000 years from now. One historian, the way he's kind of put it, he's kind of put it cynically, I suppose, but the way he's put it is to suggest that, well, the reason Constantine became a Christian and whatnot wasn't so much because he was going to help it win, but because it had already won and he wanted to back a winner. And the reason that the canon wasn't produced for so long, in part, was because Christians were kind of like dying a lot. There wasn't much peace around the empire. They were being persecuted. And when you're being persecuted, you don't really have time to compile your documents for the sake of the world. So the short answer is, do we have anything beyond the Gospels about Jesus? Well, it's kind of a yes and a no. Yes, there are other Gospels that tell us about Jesus. Yes, there are other non-biblical documents that maybe the Romans wrote that suggest Jesus existed. But really, the Gospels are the primary source. So I hope that answers your question. There's nothing to hide if that's what you're concerned about. There's no grand scheme that Dan Brown's behind trying to convince everyone that Jesus married some French lady, which is, he married Mary Magdalene and then somehow her descendant ended up in France, which is, don't read Dan Brown is the lesson from that comment.
And just to be encouraged that the Gospels are great historical recounts in and of themselves.
Yeah, I think that's fair to say.
As Christians tend to get worried about that, don't we? And a guy by the name of Sir William Ramsay, who was a archaeologist back in sort of around early 1900s, was the head of archaeology at Oxford University, started off on his quest of researching the biblical accounts and the history of those accounts, especially Luke, his Acts and the Gospel of Luke, and found out that Luke's records of the people groups match up 100%. And at that time, there was a lot. For example, they thought that a governor in the first century ruled the island of Crete, when in fact, Luke says it was a proconsul. Guess what? They've discovered that it was. It wasn't a governor. It was a proconsul. Luke was right. And this particular man ended up becoming a Christian because of the evidence. And he calls Luke the greatest of all historians. He thinks he's the top rank historian. So I think just to be encouraged that what we have in the Gospels are good and reliable.
I think one other comment about that is that we often look at the Bible as a single source. Oh, it's in the Bible. But actually, it's better to look at the Bible not as a single source, but as a library. Mm. And so is what you actually you have. You don't have one gospel. You have four independent gospels that testify to, or three of them testify to broadly the same kind of work, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Most people think that Mark was written first and then that Matthew and Luke borrowed from Mark and then drew upon some of their own sources. And then you have John, who does his own thing. But they're not one source. They're actually four independent sources. And I guess you need to keep that in mind as you read them. Because some people say, oh, this is just what the Bible says. Well, actually, it's yes, but it's actually a collection of multiple sources that we have. So something to keep in mind as well.
Yeah, that's encouraging. Okay, the next question. What would you say to a person who objects with, it doesn't make sense that the disciples waited 30 plus years to start documenting the events of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection? So how would you respond to that accusation?
First of all, that's a really good question. The first thing I would actually say is that the primary reason they didn't start writing their stuff earlier was in large part because it was an oral culture. That it was a verbal culture, not like what we have today. You know, these days you tell a student one thing, done. How the other, you know, you've got to repeat. But back then, much more of an oral culture, a lot of memorizing. You would meet ancient Jewish rabbis who had memorized the entire Old Testament. Like, we cry if we have to memorize a verse. And you've got ancient rabbis who've got, you know, they're just reeling off verses from Isaiah and Deuteronomy and, you know, everything. Like, very verbal oral culture. So why did they wait 30 years, give or take? Roughly, Mark was somewhere probably in the early 60s, is I think the consensus. Some people think it might have been a bit earlier. Some people put it later. As with any historical investigation, there's variance in what people think. But one of the reasons they began to start writing these records down was because people were beginning to die. And if these messages were going to continue on to the next generation, they wanted to get them written down. The other reason that they even, in fact, were written down at all was for the sake of missionary purposes. How are you going to tell people about Jesus in Rome without a gospel to take to them eventually and that sort of thing? So one of the reasons that it took a while was because it was a verbal, oral culture. And if you want there's a whole sort of new line of studies where they're called memory studies. So people are investigating the role of the memory in antiquity and how reliable it was in passing on information. So you can look at that. Borkum's book down here, but just as a little aside, if you want to know some of my sources for tonight, I've got a bunch of books down here for the really brave and also for the not so brave, varying in length and quality and readability and that sort of thing. But go and have a look at them. But one of them down there is by a guy called Richard Borkum called Jesus and the Eyewitnesses. And his work is really good in this field. But yeah, oral culture, they began to write them primarily because people were dying, the primary witnesses were beginning to die, so got to get their testimony for posterity, and that also helps the missionary movement. The other thing I'll say about the Gospels, now, granted, they took a bit of time to be written, but Paul's letters are actually earlier. Your Gospels appear at the front of the New Testament, but they weren't the first written. The likelihood is that the earliest document written by Paul was probably Thessalonians or Galatians. And they were probably written, I'm going from memory now, somewhere I think in the late 40s, mid to late 40s, from memory, but someone will probably correct me if I'm wrong there. I do remember Corinthians, because I looked it up for researching this. Corinthians was written in 54 AD, give or take a year. So that only puts you 20 years, if you like, from Jesus's crucifixion. And if you think about that, that means that the gospel message has somehow gotten from Jerusalem in Israel, to Corinth within 20 years. So it has started to spread at that point around the empire. And Paul's writing letters to all these brand new churches, and they are written before the Gospels. So it's not that the Gospels are the earliest, but yeah, they did wait for various reasons. And then when they did write, they wrote for various purposes. So, yeah. And sorry, one other thing. I don't know if any of you have written a book, but a book's hard work, man. A systematic theology takes forever. I haven't written one, but you don't write it in a week. Luke says that he investigated everything very carefully. And one theory is that, there are a couple of theories, but one theory is that Luke was actually funded by Theophilus to travel around the empire and actually interview the eyewitnesses, and that obviously takes time to compile. One other theory about Luke is that it was actually prepared as the Apostle Paul's courtroom defense, which is why Acts ends when it does. So, a few theories out there, but something to think about.
Yeah, no, very interesting. You mentioned enemies of Jesus attesting to his resurrection. So, who were they? And are these primary accounts?
Okay, we'll rewind there. Enemies don't testify to his resurrection. His enemies don't want to acknowledge the resurrection. His enemies acknowledge the empty tomb. So just to clear that up, the enemies actually acknowledge the empty tomb. But they obviously, when I say Jesus' enemies, I'm talking about his opponents as we have them in the narratives of the Gospels. So none of them, so far as we can tell, dispute the empty tomb. It's there, and that's why Matthew goes on record, for example, as I said, to say, remember those rumors about what the guards said? Yeah, you know, you've heard those. That rumor was started by them, but there was an empty tomb. So, and obviously, they don't want that to, they have a vested interest in sort of making sure that that's the story that's the official version. So it's not that Jesus' enemies accepted his resurrection. They didn't. But what they did accept was, the tomb's empty. And then it was, according to Matthew, that was blamed on the disciples stealing the body. Although I never figured out how the sleeping soldiers knew that it was the disciples stealing the body because they were asleep. So it's a pretty weak alibi in any event. But that was the story that was circulated. And Matthew was able to sort of use that story because his readers know that, they've heard those stories. Yeah. So,
I've heard John Dixon mention that the tomb would be actually marked.
So with a Roman seal.
With a Roman seal. And if it was broken, those soldiers were accountable and it was pain of death.
Yep.
So You've also got that issue.
Yeah, just for the record, John Dixon is a much superior historian to who I am. And I will take John Dixon's word, but he is right on. Yeah, he's definitely right on that. And if you quote John Dixon, I'll just say, yep.
Sure.
Move on.
Yeah.
So.
Another great resource. Yeah.
Yeah.
While we're talking about him. Okay. So now I'm pretty sure this question is by Dave Dalton. No? Did you write a question?
There's no need to name anyone.
Oh, right.
No need to name anyone.
No, it just ends if he gets extra credits for being here. So I was wondering if it was one of your students.
I do have one or two friends here.
Have you got students here?
Okay. Only one, but...
Well, let's see. Let's see the question. If Jesus was crucified, it would be assumed that the Romans would have documented his flogging and his crucifixion. I've heard rumors of such documentation from people. Why aren't these documents not used in the argument to support the death and resurrection of Jesus, or at the very least his existence?
Short answer is I don't know. As we discussed tonight, the Roman, like other Roman historians, like I quoted Josephus, for example, Tacitus is another one around that time, but they do give testimony that people were crucified and this is how it happened. Whether or not they had access to any of the stuff that happened to Jesus, I couldn't tell you, and I don't know why we don't have anything specific to Jesus' crucifixion by other Roman historians. At a guess, one of the reasons may be is that some of those historians simply didn't pay much attention to Jerusalem and to Israel because it was on the outskirts of the empire. Sure. That's only a guess. There is a citation in Josephus, although allegedly that was snuck in there by someone else who wanted to testify to Jesus. I don't know if that's the case or not. So it's a good question, and unfortunately I can't give you a concrete answer, but like you said, we have documentation of crucifixions and the like, and I talked about some of them tonight. Why aren't there any specifically of Jesus from those outside the Bible? I honestly couldn't tell you. So that's just an I don't know, unfortunately. Alternative facts is what we'll go with there. Maybe. Not quite, but yeah. Sorry, good question. You stumped me. Come to college. Sucker punch for PBC. if anyone is interested in studying, there really is stuff out the back. We'd love to have you. And I know Brad Shannon can testify to that. So go harass him afterwards. You're welcome. For the record, yeah, that's good. That's on the podcast, so awesome. It's there for posterity.
And you've also got great resources like Gary Habermas and Mike Lacona, who have brought about something called Minimal Facts of the Resurrection. Gary Habermas is probably one of the leading scholars on the resurrection of Jesus. I think he's committed 40 years of study to it, and they've come up with, what are the minimal facts that every scholar, no matter how liberal or how Christian they are, all agree upon? And one of those facts is that there was a man by the name of Jesus Christ who was crucified by the Romans. So I think there's a bit of a consensus there anyway among scholarship.
Yeah, there is. And there's, on that minimal facts thing, for those of you who know John Piper, Desiring God and that sort of thing, there is actually a brief article, I think it was published in 2009-ish by one of their guys, and it's basically a minimal facts approach to the resurrection, and it's very easily accessible if you just searched history of the resurrection on Desiring God. I reckon that article would come right to the top and you can read it for yourself. So, and it's just like the Cliff Notes version of what guys like Lycona and Borkum and N.T. Wright have produced, so you don't need to read 3,000 pages. Go read the 3-page summary. That's true. Yes.
Yeah.
So
absolutely.
Go do it.
All right. Is your representation of the Gospels as being publicly available documents fair? If the Christian movement was initially very small and the earliest records are 35 years after the fact, do we then expect an outcry of it is false?
which is exactly what you get from the likes of Ehrman and Crossan
absolutely.
And that sort of thing. So what to say to that? Are they publicly accessible documents? Well, yes. That's how we have them today, because they were, in fact, publicly accessible. The New Testament is the most... how do I say this? If you were to look at the ancient copies and records of the New Testament, we actually have more copies of the New Testament than we have of any other ancient document by a significant margin. I think it's in the tens of thousands. I think it's approaching 30,000 copies of the New Testament from the ancient world. And I think those numbers are right. There's a book down there that tells you Lee Strobel, The Case of Christ. Were they publicly available? Well, yes, because they were actually written and copied and copied and copied so that people could actually read them as well. And of course, at that point, someone would say, they were copied. Chances for embellishing detail and mistakes and this and this and this and then. And after so many copies, it's totally different. It's like you went fishing and it was this big, right? Possible, but if you actually compare the ancient documents and they've done the maths on this, and I hate maths, so I take them at their word. But the consistency of the copies of the New Testament up to about, I think it's 28,000-30,000 copies, and I'm happy to be corrected on that number if anyone has the exact number. I could be wrong, but I think the percentage of accuracy and consistency is above 99%, which is to say that no one changed anything along the way. Now you're like, now what's that 1%? Surely that's important. Well, not really. It's often a spelling mistake. Sometimes it's an incorrect vowel or something like that. And in the cases where we know there has been some discrepancy from an earlier source, you can usually tell by comparing the other sources which is the most reliable copy that we have. And again, at near enough to 30,000 copies, 99% accuracy, I think it's fair to say that A, yeah, it was public, because there are that many copies, and B, much more accurate than any other ancient document that we have in antiquity. So that would be my answer. And I'd also have you recall that, the Gospels were written quite a bit after the fact for reasons that we've talked about, oral culture and stuff like that. But let's take Paul, for example, who wrote 1 Corinthians in about 54 AD. He actually cites what most scholars think is a creed when he talks about the resurrection in chapter 15. And so obviously that creed goes back to an earlier time. And some scholars think that it could go back as early as Paul's own conversion when he first became a Christian. And that would take you back to about 34 AD, within a year of the events. So at that point, you start to get really close. Now, that's a little bit of that's conjecture, but it's not unreasonable to think that Paul would have come across this creed upon his conversion. That's perfectly legitimate to suggest. And if that is the case, you get to within a year of the event. So it's very, very fresh, and certainly no time for legendary development to take place.
I was listening to a guy by the name of James Crossley, who's a New Testament critic, non-Christian, atheist, and he would agree to that. He would say that 1 Corinthians chapter 15 was written somewhere in the mid-30s. This is early.
Well, you mean the creed?
The creed was recited and was pretty much straight after the death and resurrection of Jesus.
Yeah. I have been to a pub with James Crossley. He wouldn't remember me, but...
Wow. Yeah, no. I listened to him on a podcast, so...
One of the weird things about being in a PhD program is you start to rub shoulders with scholars who have written books like this, and it's very surreal, so... Just casual name drop there. There was stupid story, but I'll share it. I was late to a conference paper that was happening. Well, it was actually a seminar, and my supervisor was sort of chairing it, but the talkers were... some people that you may have heard of, Tom Wright, N.T. Wright, John Barclay, who's another eminent New Testament scholar in the UK, Michael Gorman, was another one who some of you may have heard of, and Peter Oakes from Manchester. And I was late, and the only seat was at the very front between Peter Oakes and John Barclay. And I got the death glare from, like, what the heck is this guy doing here? He doesn't belong here. But it was fun. But it's just surreal, and you rub shoulders. So, and then after that, out at a pub somewhere in St. Andrews, and, oh, there's James Crossley grabbing a whiskey. There he is. There you go. Strange.
Pretty cool. Pretty cool.
Still strange to me.
Yeah. Absolutely.
He wouldn't know me from a bar, so it's true.
Well, I just really want to thank David for your time. Really appreciate you. More information on our Facebook page. There's obviously articles always coming up that have something to do with apologetics in that world, and also information about our next event, our next Think Lecture. So thanks once again.